Hey, everybody out there in Orange Whip Nation, welcome to today's webinar. Sorry we're a few minutes late, but got a lot of great stuff coming up here for you. Jim Hackenberg and Brian Newman will be talking you through the four must-haves for a good golf swing and the four must-haves on how to train to have that good golf swing. So some great content coming up. Just a few things to note. It's going to be about a 45-minute webinar. Many of you have probably been on before. There's Q&A. Hit the Q&A button on your dashboard and ask us some questions, and we'll get to as many of them as we can. Take the survey. As soon as you close out of the webinar, it'll pop up on your screen, a survey. You'll also get it in a follow-up email after the webinar, I believe, tomorrow. Please email us info@orangewhiptrainer.com for any of your questions or needs. We're happy to talk to all of our customers and anybody out there that has any questions regarding any of our products, our programs, or just want to say hello. Also have a phone number there. We do like to talk to people in person, believe it or not. Follow us on social media. There you go, @OrangeWhipGolf. We appreciate the follows, and we'll get as many cool content and commercials and everything up there, and hopefully you guys can gain some knowledge from that. Let's get into it here. Jim Hackenberg, you all know him. He's the developer and CEO of Orange Whip Golf, PGA professional out of the Carolinas. He'll be joining us. Many of you will recognize him. And also Brian Newman, he's the director of instruction and fitness at Orange Whip Golf and Fitness. He's the co-founder of Golf Fitness X, and when it comes to golf and movement and training and physical fitness, he pretty much has all the accreditations you need. He's also a 2001 award winner of the Golf Fitness Association of America. So let's get started here. I'll turn it over to Brian and Jim, and they'll walk you through the four must-haves.
Hey, everybody. Thank you for joining us. We always enjoy putting these webinars on. And what's great about this one, usually we're operating remotely, but I'm in South Carolina at the headquarters with these guys. We're shooting brand new content for our upcoming app. So it's been an exciting few days. After about 15 workouts, though, I'm ready to eat. But obviously, you know, Jim. And what we always try to do with these webinars is give you usable information to apply to your own golf game. So what we're going to do is be able to talk about those four must-haves, show you what you need to get those, and they're going to tie in with those other four must-haves for a successful training program. So again, these are things that over the years of teaching and training that have really been able to solidify the success and the improvements that our students are able to have. Again, these are the things that good players do very often. And Jim here, he's going to be chiming in and chatting a little bit about the Orange Whip itself and how it can assist those must-haves big time, working through just some typical things that you like to do with the whip. And we're going to be walking you through some drills and some routines, right, that can help you apply this stuff right away. So let's dive into it.
Yep.
Okay. So the four must-haves you saw in the Zoom call there that setup, backswing, impact, and finish. And there's portions of those things in a successful golf swing that we have to do, right? And what I always define them as is the swing skills. And a lot of times in any educational program, it's understanding those big muscle movements and the challenges we have based on our body limitations, our coordination. And again, you can see how these are going to tie together. So one thing that I love is starting with setup, right? And the thing about setup is this would be also considered a fundamental, right? You've heard that a lot. So what we mean by that when we talk about fundamentals is things like posture in your golf swing, right? Ball position, grip, those things when you go to your PGA professional that he's an expert in and helping you get aligned, right? Helping control your club face. So those are those fundamentals that we want to do. And previously in my teaching experience doing golf schools, we came up with a simple routine to check all of those boxes, right? So normally when we're sticking with the body movements, we want to make sure that you understand that fundamentals are very important and they're unique to each individual. So again, go see your golf professional, and then we can help you with these major movements that we're going to talk about once we get past those fundamentals. So I want you to take note of this. If you're at home, grab an umbrella, a pencil, a club, an orange whip, whatever you can find, and I want you to walk through this. I'm going to be teaching Jim how to do it. And there's some neat things the orange whip does to enhance this too. We were doing them yesterday.
Yep, absolutely. Yep. Yeah, just the unique weight of the orange whip and the flexibility gives you a different sensation and a different feel when you're working on your fundamentals. And as Brian said, with proper fundamentals, it makes everything else so much easier. And it makes it just, your golf swings become more athletic, more functional. And you know what? You're going to hit it further. You're going to play much better. So yeah, let's get right into the setup positions.
Yeah. So these... We're going to talk about the tendencies, and what we're doing is attacking the tendencies with this routine, right? And when teaching fundamentals, what gets hard for a student is when I call it the Rolodex of tips starts going through the head, right? And that's why we like our training program. It helps eliminate those as well as the orange whip. So the way to get rid of those where you're not standing over the ball and saying, all right, ball position forward, I need to tilt more forward, I need to turn my grip, I need to do that. We've created a routine for you to walk in to the shot and ensure that they're in the right places. All right. So we're going to start with grip. Now, again, this is unique to each individual. We're going to just show you one that hits on the points that we see that are across the board, right? No matter what your grip is, strong, weak, whatever, we're always going to see players have the tendency to get the grip in the fingers, right? And that, again, that and that nice pinch that we see there with those best players. And the reason we need it in those fingers is what you can see here, and Jim and I were doing this yesterday, and he was talking about the weight. You can see, I mean, this orange whip, pound and a half, right, or the midsize, has some weight to it. And without moving my elbow, I'm able to start to create hinges there, and that's, again, in those fingers. When I'll have Jim demonstrate, as soon as he puts it in the palm, do you see the first thing he has to start to do to create a lever? One, he either lifts his arm up, or two, he's got to use his elbow, right? So when we don't have that in the fingers, we eliminate that ability to create that those hinges, which are a major power source. So again, as a must-have, this falls into those categories big time.
And it's also a balancing act. When you have it in the proper position in the fingers and the pad on the back of the hand, you can balance it and find where it is the most solid and secure in the sense of how I can make a swing without having to hang on tight or grab it too much.
Right. It's resting in the fingers. So the tendency we see again is it's too much in the palms. And how many of you, I hear this tip often, it's, you know, a little bit of a parking lot pro tip, I like to say, but keep your lead arm straight. Well, how can I keep my lead arm straight if I'm going to swing an object this way and I have no lever system? I'm going to start to fold that arm, right, and not be able to utilize that hinge position. So what I'm going to have now is how do I get it in the fingers every time, right, without having to necessarily mentally check that box before I go. So as you can see how Jim's standing, he's got that orange whip right to his side where his arms are hanging. And naturally when you do that, so if you rest this on the ground, and again, this would be your club, or again, when you grab your orange whip, when that hand's hanging by your side, right, you can't get it in the palm. I would have to physically get underneath of it. So Jim right now has it in these fingers. And what I like to say to test it is to play the piano on the back of that grip. So if Jim rests his hand, he's able to tap those fingers. And then again, for you to test this, next time you go to the range, I want you to play it in the fingers there. And then I want you to pick this up, all right, even with the orange whip because of the weight. And I want you to remove your pointer finger and your thumb. Do you see how this didn't move at all? So that shows Jim's creating support between the palm of his hand, right, and those fingers. So this is, again, a great way to start your routine is to start with that club hanging by your side. And you'll notice if you start watching the best players in the world, a lot of them, when they start behind the ball, have this. You don't even notice it, right? They're tapping on it or they're banging the driver on the ground. But they actually are doing that, and they're not even thinking about their grip because it's a habit. But this is an easy way to make sure that you do it. So when you start this routine, I want you to be behind the ball, right? And I want you to play in those fingers, right? And you can always test it from that point, all right? From there, the right hand comes on. Play the piano, and, you know, again, from there, we want to make sure that we have that nice grip. I don't care if you baseball grip it. I don't care if you overlock it. I don't care if you interlock it. Again, it's a tendency as well. If we start to go strong or weak, that's between you and your pro in terms of what we're seeing in ball flight and tendencies. All right, but overall, every good grip is going to be in those fingers for the most part, and that back of that palm. So we've got the grip on there. That's a major one to then start to use our proper muscles. So as we get into that, one of the things I want you to pay attention to is proper training is using the proper muscles. So if you're trying to train your golf swing, you're swinging the orange whip or doing some or doing our fitness program, if you've got that thing in the grip, it's going to be very hard for you to do the things we want to do and use those levers properly, right? All right, so we've got the grip on there. We're going to talk how that plays into the bigger movements as we go. And then the next thing we want to do is hit posture, right? And posture we define as our bends, right? Forward and back and trail to lead, right? So what we want to do is that when we set up, we want to have that routine that's going to help us do that. So Jim right now is behind the golf ball. All right. And again, you can practice this with your whip. Again, it gets the club face kind of out of the way like we like and lets you just feel free to move through this and then work on the club face then. So again, Jim would be behind the ball. And Jim, what I want you to do is I want you to walk into the shot and I want you to put that ball with your feet together. I want you to put that ball smack in the center of your stance.
And what's great about this is I'm looking down the line at my target. So I'm, you know, get the feel for the grip and the club. And again on the target, because this is all golf. And we always want to focus on where we're going. Get my grip ready. Now I move into this line that I've already drawn, and I've got my feet now, even with the golf ball.
Right. So Jim has this ball directly in the center of his stance with his feet together. So what that does is that does two things. One, it places the ball in the center of his stance. We're going to talk ball position next. But what I like, and Jim did it without even thinking about it, is that when he walks in, it's a great opportunity to allow those arms to hang and start to create that little bit of front bend in the chest, right? So at this point, we've got that the grip in the fingers. We walk in, the ball's in the center of the feet, and we create that little hinge in the hips, right? Not much, right? Just a little kickback. I like to think about if you had groceries right in your hands, you had to close your car door, you'd hit it with your rear end a little bit, right? You're not going to dent your car door. You don't want to hit it too hard. It's just a little kick. And the big thing that I like here is the arm hang, right? Again, this is a natural arm hang position. So when we get into golf, right? Again, proper muscle contraction is part of our training. These muscles in the back need to be active. And if we start to move away, we're going to start to, again, recruit those arms, those biceps, all those things. Obviously, we use, but they're going to be that armsy swinger, right? I know a lot of us are out there battling that. So, again, we walk in. The feet are together. Jim's got a little bit of hang in those arms, which, again, gives him that nice tilt. And then because we placed the ball in the center of the stance, and this is a big one because it determines a lot, we're going to be able to set that ball position the same way every single time. All right, so keep in mind, again, Jim has already created his alignment, right? And he's aiming down the target line. You can pick an intermediate target. You know, it's a great way to do it. Jack Nicklaus always said a couple yards in front. But from here, what I'm going to do, depending on the club, right, I'm going to have Jim, let's say he's hitting a wedge, right? I'm going to have you step with your left, step with your right, the same distance. So if we take two steps of equal distance, where does that put the ball?
Right in that middle.
Exactly in the middle. I don't care how you're built. If you stand with your feet together and clap your arms together, right, and then I take two equal steps, it's always going to be in the middle of the body unless you have something crazy going on. But again, that's why we have the feet together. I can't kick my hips and get out of place. So again, you can see these check marks as we go through this process. All right. If we have a hybrid, Jim, go ahead, put your feet back together. I want you to take a small or a medium step with the lead foot and then a larger step with the other foot. So naturally, where does that put that ball?
Closer to the front. It's in front of the center. It's not quite to my left heel, but it's a little bit closer to the left foot in front of center line.
Yeah. So you know what? Dr. Suddy, who's a great instructor, he told me it's the logo of your shirt, which makes sense because if Jim turns his feet in or out, it can actually create a visual that it's in a different spot.
Yeah.
So I love that. And again, the thing is that if I told Jim to put that off the center of his shirt, I'm going to have to show him, I'm going to have to tell him that his eyes are potentially showing him something different because he may say that's so far forward,
yeah.
Right? So again, if we do this step system, it's going to tell him what's going on without me having to talk that much, right? So last but not least is driver, right? And again, the ball position, this is just a blanket over these ball positions. Some teachers are going to get even more specific, but we want to just give you a blanket because start by checking these boxes to have those four must-haves, right? All right, so for driver, we're really going to take a teeny tiny step or almost leave that left foot there and then take a big step with that trail foot. All right, so then naturally from there, we see a couple things. Number one, ball position moves closer to the front. I like off the lead arm. Why do you think I like off the lead arm? What do we want to see with the driver on the angle of approach? Up, right?
Yep.
So what I like is that it's on the outside of this arm. So if you think about a, if Jim's just rocking his shoulders, where does a club start to work upwards? On the outside of that arm.
Yeah.
Right. So I really like what Jim's doing there. And then naturally what he did too, and this is one that I really want you to pay attention to, and you can do this as well. I'll show you a little trick. But Jim, when he takes that step properly, where's your pressure move with the driver?
Moves back into the inside of the.
Yeah, you're stabilizing. And what that's doing is his upper body is getting that side bend, right? So turn towards the camera for me so they can see that. So when I'm on the range, I can look at this and know probably, you know, if I see this, I know what type of swing tendency we're probably going to see, right? So if you struggle with this, if you struggle with a steep driver swing, right, really spinny, hit that big fade that doesn't go anywhere, or you trap it, right? We want to make sure we're in this position. So again, if we're struggling with that, and it, Jim did a great job of ball position, I think that's, that it's going to help a lot. But when Jim puts his feet together, go ahead and go back to that.
Should I do it from this position here?
Yeah, so feet together. That's perfect. Yep. All right. So bring that club up in front. You just put your grip on there, right? Let's say you're hitting that driver.
Okay.
Right. So from this position, I just want Jim to give me a little side bend. All right. And then we can step those feet apart. So again, we felt that with the feet together, it's so much easier than trying to understand where that is, especially with that driver and that little bit of side tilt. You know, tour average is tilted back there a few degrees, right?
And the beauty is, I mean, just by positioning my feet in such a way, I have to tilt that way.
Exactly. Exactly. So again, some reference points to make sure you're doing it right. We talked about the logo, so you can reference this, look at it, or use video to help you do that. The one thing I like too is the placard of his shirt right now is pointing towards that lead foot. So look down at your shirt, right? And then is it this way or is it pointing down? And again, this is driver, right? So again, keep that in mind. Now, let's talk about our training must-haves as we're on this topic.
Yep.
If you lack the strength, right, or the understanding of how to do side bend, Jim made it look easy, but there's a lot of people who are going to be tight in those obliques and really not understand how to do this and incorporate it with their golf swing. So when we talk about the must-haves, we have to have, so if I had a ding sound, ding one would be, we have to train coordination, right? We have to train our body how to create that side bend. And we also have to make sure that our program gets us physically capable from, again, this would be another point, range of motion. And this one is pretty simple. A lot of people can be able to do that. But again, I see people who have that high left shoulder, that really dominant lead side, or they walk up and they're like this, even due to injury. So again, with our training program, we want to make sure that we're working that coordination in and as well getting that body ready. All right. So what I mean by that is that your routines, when you're swinging on the range, when you're using the orange whip, I want you to make sure that you're matching what we want to do. The great thing about training, and when I define training, it means swing training, we call it, right? It's moving through the golf swing motions, adding in some standard exercises, but making sure that our coordination is proper. And again, by training, it's going to take a lot of the thought process out too, just like swinging the orange whip, right? Yep. We swing the orange whip for a couple minutes. That's swing training. You're working on coordination. The orange whip's helping you with the range of motion, again, which is one of those four, as well as the tempo, right? If we want to really have that tempo, that's the speed of motion as well. All right. So I like that little fundamental routine. That's little outside, you know, again, teaching pro background. I want you to be able to start with that. So then we can move into the other elements, but you can see how the four must-haves are coming into the swing itself as we continue to do this right now. So, all right. So Jim had a good setup. What it's going to look like from the top, and I'll go ahead if you want to demonstrate it. So I want you to start from behind the ball this time.
Okay.
And I want you to start and go through those steps. And I want you to do it with your regular speed. You would do it on the golf course.
Okay.
All right. So again, keep in mind
from a driver perspective.
Yeah. Let's do it from driver. So you're going to be standing behind the ball. So come over here like you're aiming.
We'll do it this
way. Or you can do it that. Yeah. Go ahead and do it that way. Yeah. So right now, Jim's starting. Where's he got the club? In the fingers. He's even starting to give it that waggle, right? All right. Go ahead and walk into it. Step, step. And do it. All right. So now let's do it again. And I want you to do it with some speed like you would be comfortable
Okay.
working through this stuff, right?
So comfortable here, looking down the line, got it in my hand, put it in my other hand, walking and looking at my target, get my feet centered, boom, boom.
So does that look familiar to the stuff we see on television? Best players in the world, right? So it's step by step right now, but if we speed that up and start to make that a habit, it looks pretty normal, right? And then as you get better with the feet, you'll also see the feet placement maybe start by positioning the foot as we get better at it. But I want you to start with those feet together to start to understand that step process.
So, coming into winter, you know, a lot of us aren't going to play as much golf as we do in the summer. But just to even do the step in routine to get used to it, when you come back in the spring, it'll be automatic. You won't think twice about it. It'll just be
right.
You do each time.
Exactly. So again, talking about the physical capabilities of nailing that setup and stabilizing, Jim actually has our turn trainer on. He's been wearing it as we've been doing that. And again, a lot of us, this setup looks pretty basic for us, right? I get that nice position. If you draw two lines up my ankles, I'm nice and balanced. But there's a lot of time where we have these hip imbalances as well. Those two bands running straight down his leg. So this is a turn trainer. We just don't have any turn set in it right now. These, what are you feeling when you're in this position? You've got to be feeling certain movements.
Yeah, absolutely. Because there's a desire to get it to pull down, but I'm kind of restricting it. But it's also making sure my body is stable, balanced, and the core is engaged.
Right. And if you get too wide in that stance, what are those bands going to want to do?
Yeah, just pulling. I mean, yeah. It's just,
they're going to want to make you athletic. So if I told you to jump right now, right, did you see where his feet went right away? They went directly under your hips. All right. So this is a great way to feel that. In addition, right, we talk about that little posture kick to make sure that looks good. These bands, when we move them more to the back, right, we widen the belt, it's going to give you that feel of where to go. And it's also going to help contract your core to not compromise your low back. And what I mean by that is a lot of people set up in this S posture position, too much curvature in that low back.
Yep.
I'm using muscles I really don't want to be using, and my core's turned off, right? Yep. The bands on the back of the belt are actually going to get me more in a core active position and allow me to feel where I need to be there. So wear those in this routine, and we're doing what? We're hitting some of those pieces of four must-haves in our training program: muscle contraction, range of motion, coordination, and speed, right? So that is, I want you to take that away. I want you to try that. Those can be major game changes, and then from there, we at least have those boxes checked. For those of you who filled out our routine questionnaire, you should have access to those videos actually on our website where we go through the fundamentals and we get even more in depth with alignment and some of those other things. All right. So start with those fundamentals. Now let's move into the full swing, the dynamic movements that we really like. And, you know, moving away from setup, speaking of setup, our new program we were shooting is we were speeding up that routine, that setup routine, and working those tilts a lot. So again, we're excited to bring this new content out where we're really making sure that you're going to be able to do this without a lot of thought because we're doing it in our training program, that coordination, right? All right, so let's talk about backswing. So now that we have backswing, what I want you to do is I'm going to have Jim spin this turn trainer. So he's going to pick it up. We're going to bring this left side.
Okay.
Or actually, yeah, you had it right. We're going to bring this side. And we're going to go into backswing assistance. So this is going to help his backswing pattern, right?
Yep.
How to do it. It's going to help his range of motion. And what I mean by that is as he has this twisted, it's going to pull this hip, right? When he does that and we make sure that we stay stable, right? And if we had the peel, we'd be getting, you know, again, the peel is great for this. But this is going to help create mobility in this trail hip. This is so vital. What are the tendencies we see in the backswing?
Sway,
reverse pivot. They're all, a lot of those are caused by this incorrect pattern and
it's
lack
really hard
of
to
rotation.
Do that with this on as well. It's very difficult to move that way because it wants to go this way.
Exactly. So what I love, again, with a good training program, where these products, right, are going to help us hit those points, right? So again, turn trainer is going to help us do that. And then there's some drills that we use in our training program that we're going to add to that. You know, we use these products in our training program because they accelerate the learning process. You can't do this wrong.
Mm-mm.
It's going to move you.
Yep.
It's going to help the range of motion, muscle contraction, activate that core and speed of motion, right? We're going to see that nice turn in there.
And if you're playing every day, you may be easily make this motion. You take a month off in the winter, you're going to go about a fraction of where you were in July. So this is encouraging me to make that big full summer turn all year long.
Exactly. So talking about the must-haves, when we talk coordination, the turn trainer is great as well, because now we can actually take our functional training from the gym and bring it right to the range, because we can actually hit balls with the turn trainer. So let's say that you lack turn in your backswing. It's super common, right? If you also lack, if you stand up, which is the most reported swing flaw that we get when we run our questionnaires, is standing up, right? So if you stand up and lack that rotation, this turn trainer, it's not only pulling you in rotation, but where's it pulling that lead hip? Down, right? Yeah. So again, the takeaways I want you to pay attention to. I want to see rotation, right? Go ahead and turn. And here's our checkpoint. I want to see this belt buckle turn out towards that trail foot, or what we would define as, you know, again, getting a little technical, go ahead and relax, is this 45 degree mark, right? So if you're at home, I want you to make a backswing and see where this belt buckle points, right? So that's that rotation key. In addition, I want you to make a backswing and I want you to tell me, all right, go ahead and hold this across your hips, right on your belt line. Go ahead and make your backswing. Where is this club pointing, right? A lot of us are going to be where's our tendency? Flat, right? So you could see the turn trainer is going to pull us down in that. Again, coordination is a must have, right? You can train all you want. You can be super strong. It doesn't matter unless it matches our golf swing patterns. All right. So again, the turn trainer is pulling that lead hip down. When that lead hip comes down, what's that lead shoulder do?
Tilting down too.
Yep. So I see it all the time. People are like, oh, I need to stay down more. And that lead hip's flat. So I'm saying good luck getting that much mobility and core strength to do it. So again, I want you to check at home, right? Our big tendencies in the backswing are that sway, that reverse pivot, and standing up. Start with that lower body movement, right? Get that belt buckle inside of that foot. Get that lead hip below. I like to say, this is my favorite analogy about this. Go ahead. Right now, you see how Jim's hips are level? I want you to think about if you were standing in a swimming pool. Go ahead and make your backswing. Where would your lead hip go in the water? So the water would be right on your belt line. It would dip into the water, right?
And this would pop out a T.
Exactly. So now if you went back to neutral in your forward swing, we level out again. And then on the forward side, we drop into the water again. So I really like that. We do that. I think we call it flextensions. We put the whip across. We feel that dip in the water, back to neutral, and dip in the water. So many of you are out there trying to make swing fixes and you're unaware of this major pattern that we have that all tour players do. I promise you, there may be an outlier, but it's not that far outside of those movements. All right. So posture, I want you to pay attention, do that test for me, right? And that bend. All right. So in addition, we have a test I like to do for this backswing. Again, I want you to be able to use this. So go ahead and set up, take your golf grip. All right. Go ahead and go up to the top for me. Since Jim's rotation and posture are good, Jim, I want you to go ahead and give, I want you to, just for the sake of the test, I want you to tap your lead foot. So you can see how he's fully lifting that. He's not going to do this in a swing, but you'll notice here, he doesn't have to move his head very far.
Yeah, I could not do my right foot, but my left foot I can do.
Right. Well, you're loading in all your pressures in that right foot. So if I gave you reverse pivot motion, could you lift that foot without swing?
No.
All right. Exactly. Right. Or go ahead and give me that big sway. All right. Now he's lifting it by cheating. His head moved too far.
Exactly.
Okay. So what happens is if our bends and our turns are good, normally our weight shift's going to follow. Right. And I want you to use those keys, right? Pay attention to your hip line. This is backswing, major key, right? Pay attention to where it's going. That's our coordination, right? Range of motion. How far is that going, right? Am I able to get there? And in your training program, we need to make sure of that. It's one of those four components of functional fitness, right? In addition, the speed of motion, right? Naturally, you could turn your hips too far, but it's probably going to affect your bends and turns, right? And you can over-rotate at this position. And if that's the case, if your belt buckle swings way past your foot, I want you to fight against that. And that's actually going to help you train too.
Sure.
This is the assisted pattern, right? So if you have a bad habit of over rotating, if your belt buckle's too far, I want you to understand that checkpoint and I want you to fight that resistance, because that's reactive training. When we pop those bands off, it's going to be a lot easier for you to stabilize, right?
Yep.
All right, so backswing, love posture, tap, tap, drill, give it a whirl. And then again, the turn trainer, you can hit balls. I like this backswing assist motion for driver or somebody who has no depth in their swing. because as soon as I create that depth, it gets them more on plane and behind and gets that chest and that arm across the body. So if you're an over the top guy, turn trainer is going to help you do this. And then using it in your training program, it's going to move into this major must have, which is backswing and our skills. All right. So what comes after backswing?
Transition.
Transition and then impact, right?
Impact.
So let's talk about what we want to see with impact and our tendencies. So now let's go into pattern assistance, and Jim's going to just spin this baby for me on that. So he's going to pull up on the bands.
Yeah, just I grab like a right near the connection points. Give it a couple
just
of
give
slow
it a
turns.
Spin. You got it. So it's an easier way than if naturally you can reach down and connect those, no problem. If you're a teaching pro utilizing these bands, I usually help connect the student. You know, I look like I'm running around them in circles. But again, you can pull up and spin it, loosen the belt slightly, and then you just go straight up and down. It's like putting on a pair of pants,
yeah.
Right? So we've really simplified this system to be able to be utilized very easily. So now what we have is we have Jim's pattern assistance on the forward swing, right? So what are the tendencies? What would be some of the flaws that we see regularly occur during that impact phase?
Well, a lot of people just stop that and they don't finish the motion. They don't allow it to complete to the target.
Exactly. There's times on video teaching a lesson where I'll have somebody walk up and see the video and they'll ask me if that person even made a swing yet. And they're at impact because they're squared up where they started there. So a lot of times what is exactly right. We're seeing a stall of the hips, right? And we're allowing those hands and arms to go by. So my low point of my swing where the ball is, I'm going to greatly struggle with that position, right? So the turn trainer, go ahead and mimic some swings here. And I'm going to bring the whip in because this whip is helping the low point, this whip's going to help tremendously the way that it's weighted, right? So go ahead and grab this, right? And I just want you to go ahead and make a few swings with the whip. And I want you to start to talk to me about what you're feeling with the turn trainer and then also how the whip is helping you do this.
Okay. Well, with the turn trainer on the backswing, I'm feeling a bit of resistance, but I'm feeling a ton of load and a ton of power that I can release all the way to that target because it's pulling me that way.
Right.
So it's a very interesting resistance here, but it's all power. And then it's all speed to the finish. Now the whip is just timing out the motion of my hands, arms, body, and footwork. The turn trainer is assisting that and exaggerating it. So I have no doubt as to what I'm trying to do, get all my momentum loaded and unloaded at the target.
Right. So Jim was training right there. I mean, your heart rate probably went up, right?
Sure, yeah.
And you were just swinging back and forth. So again, what's great about the products and doing just swinging the whip, right? We're not even adding drills at this point, is that is functional training.
Yep.
We've got coordination patterns because the products will help us do that, right? We've got muscle contraction because we've got those bands pulling us into positions we need to.
Yep.
The range of motion is going to be assisted by the whip's weight, right? As well as that turn trainer. So again, for those of you who are like, I don't work out at all, you don't have to.
Yep.
Grab the turn trainer, grab the whip, and it's going to help. And then again, the speed of motion, the whip does a great job at the transition control of the speed. All right, but if we want to have some speed occur, again, speed of motion, we have to train fast to go fast,
yep.
Right? And the thing is that brings in the light speed, right?
And let me interject this real quick, yep. Brian. When I was teaching full-time, and Brian's experienced this a lot, and actually even when I was getting golf lessons, when people try to assist my motion to speed it up, they're down below me, tucked behind. It was always uncomfortable. It was always awkward. It never felt natural. Where this is doing the exact same thing, but way more efficiently and way more accurately.
Right.
It's allowing me to turn the way my to help me turn, but this is much, it's a much easier, more comfortable way to do it.
Right. No question. So we're going to get into a drill as well. So what Jim said, usually when those hips stall out too, where do we think the arms and hands are going to try to hit the golf ball? Where do they have to go to make contact? They can't be inside.
Exactly.
Because you're going to hit this far behind.
Yep.
So if those hips stall out, right? And again, keep in mind, we can overdo rotation, but it's not very often. It's on the better player scale of spinning too fast.
Yep.
And we can assist that if we see it. There's ways to do it, and our program can address it from both sides. But that over-the-top motion, right, and that lack of lower body rotation, we're going to go over a drill that's going to help both of those, right? And then in addition, this is where – okay, speed of motion, I keep talking about it.
Yep.
It has to be functional, meaning we have to move while we train as fast as we want to swing the club. Now, there's two ways to do it. I can use a lighter object and try to make that move faster.
Yep.
Now, the thing is that potentially if I had bad habits, I could speed up my arms and hands and slow my hips down to move that object faster, right? So what's neat about the light speed is that we're using the same thing of the counterweight and the flexible shaft. And again, you cannot swing this thing incorrectly or you're not going to get the speed result and the auditory feedback that we have. So what I love about the light speed is it's a speed trainer, but it increases your swing speed using technique. And I always say it teaches you how and when to create speed and do that. So I'm going to show you a quick drill and I'm going to have you do it with the turn trainer on.
Yep.
Right. And there's a million drills that we have and we use in our training program. Again, our training program hits on all of these pieces. All you got to do is show up and press play, and we're going to help the coordination, muscle contraction, and so on. So one that I really like is called the 1-2-3 drill. And what this is going to do is incorporate the lower body action a little bit, right? As well as where we're going to have that moving. So what I like to do is I like to see the backswing. I like to see those arms and hands nice and extended, right? That turn trainer could even assist me with that. And the weight of the whip is going to help me do that as well. So you can grab the whip and do that. So we're going to go outside the hands, nice one-piece takeaway, right? From there, what I want you to do is I'm going to have Jim start to shift the weight. And as he does that, naturally with the whip and the light speed, we're going to start to see that start to fall back into the body, right? So it's outside and then back into the body. If I go in, I'm going to do the opposite way, right? So I like that nice wide takeaway, right? You can see this is right along the foot line here. So a lot of people are like, oh, I need to take it back more connected or more outside. And I see them start doing this.
Yeah.
And the problem is if you add rotation,
yeah,
it goes in that way, right? Yeah. So again, it's really that handle pointing here, that club staying outside the hands. And you can see if I drop this, it's right around that foot line.
Yep.
All right. So again, I want you to make sure that we're training that coordination. And what we're going to do is that's a wide to narrow. Look at how I'm letting that fall back in. I got it in the fingers already, right? And then from there, I have to time that with the light speed and create that speed. 1, 2, and then 3. So I can start to really feel how to create that hit and have that turn trainer do its job. The whip also is really good to time that, get the feel for the rhythm and tempo of that, and then add that light speed from that standpoint. All right. So I really like that one for over the top. I'm going to have Jim go ahead and demonstrate another one. So if you're over the top and you lack that rotation, let me see you go ahead and do that one actually. And then we'll move on to one more. So impact, we're going to do two drills because it's important. You got to check the box for the backswing, though, to be able to get in a good spot there. So nice and wide, and then I want you to let it fall into you and then go. Perfect. So what we're doing is for Jim to let it fall in, I want you to watch a sequence here. This is really good. So his arms and hands, nice and wide, and letting it fall into the body. Watch how he starts this lateral motion, right? So people say, what starts the downswing? What we're going to see is as that falls in, you can see a little pressure shift towards that left side, right? I call it surfing or on a skateboard. All right. So again, a lot of us struggle to do that because we pull from the top, yeah, right? What's good about this drill is that I have to have that timing piece, right? And the whip and the light speed are going to do that. If Jim doesn't have that timing, right? So I want you to go ahead and throw it and spin it the wrong way. So where did we hear that noise?
Yeah.
Back that way, right?
Yeah.
So again, 1-2-3 drill, I like it, covers a lot of things, right? And then let's talk about getting even more active with that lower body. And also, you know, another fall we see at impact, obviously the chicken wing, like we are talking about, a lot of those are depending on the lower body, right? But in addition to that, all right, Brian, I'm gonna get my lower body involved. And then all of a sudden we see that motion.
Yeah.
You know, so we start to get that sway too far in front of that golf ball to create that positioning, right? So what I want Jim to do, this is our rev up swing. And again, this is a great speed motion for you to be able to have that position that we want. All right. So Jim has those arms and hands out in front first. This is a great opportunity to rehearse where we want to be after impact, right? I'd even like to see Jim have that heel up a little bit more. And there we go. Good. Because this is through impact. Look how that looks. Now to point that ball in that position, what does he have to do with this shoulder? Right? It has to go down,
yep,
right? If he were forward, let's say he was this way, right? it's going to be really hard for you to just do that motion.
Oh, yeah, I can't even do it. I mean,
so exactly, preset it. And then again, what I love is go between the whip and the light speed, because if you do that incorrectly, this weight is really going to affect you if you're in the wrong position. Yeah. You see how heavy that got?
Yeah, and awkward.
Right. So again, the turn trainer is going to look how this opens him up as well. Right. So again, this is a drill that we use in speed training as well as with the whip and using this through any sort of level of fitness. Again, how do I train coordination? How do I train speed? How do I train speed of motion? These are easy ways to do it with the drills that we're going to prescribe. And then the products do a lot of the work for us. Right. So again, let's go back to the light speed. Get that club out in front. So let's talk about how I'm going to keep you behind the ball. Naturally, you're rehearsing it, which I love. All right, I'm going to have Jim initiate by swinging that light speed back. And then as he goes back, I'm going to cue him to push his hips forward and spin, right? So go ahead and go back, spin. All right, good. So what we're doing here is a lot of us lack separation, right? The first time you do this, you're going to pause and wait for your hips, and you're probably going to have that old habit come in, right? What's good about this is you notice that I cued it, right? So in our training program, I will literally be doing that. So go ahead and extend those arms out. I'm going to do it again.
Right.
Yep. Hips. Good. So what we're doing is Jim is, his hips are getting a head start because his arms and hams are out in front, right? So when I start back, my hips are in a position where I'm already starting to go. So naturally, if I have my upper body loaded with the club and I try to get my hips just a little bit of pressure shift, what do I start to create is that tilt, right?
Exactly.
So
tilt extension to the target, which is all speed.
Exactly.
And accuracy, actually. I mean, it makes it so much easier to go the direction you're swinging.
Right. So what I love is that the proof is in what's going to happen. So what I want you to do, we all have iPhones. A lot of us film our swings. I want you to film your driver swing, right? And then I want you to film you doing one of these drills with the Turn Trainer product. Again, I haven't even mentioned this, but that thing is doing a lot of the lifting in that lower half. When you're on your way back, this thing's not only turning your body, but it's laterally pulling you this way. You can see where this band is.
Yeah.
It's going to kick those hips forward, right?
Yeah, that's right.
So I want you to see that. And then how, okay, great. I did it with a product. So what? Well, the easy answer is keep the Turn Trainer on and go ahead and hit a ball for me. Right. And what Jim can even do is now with a club, I want you to do that rev up swing a couple times. All right. Okay. And give me a little ground contact.
Okay.
So out in front and hips. Good. Does your swing speed feel faster there too? Yeah. There's no question. And hips. Good. Awesome. So now with the Turn Trainer on, go ahead and set up, Jim. And I just want you to let that Turn Trainer help that sequence here.
Okay. Ready?
Yep. Send it. All right. Very good. So again, what that's going to do is that Turn Trainer is going to help do a lot of these. So again, the question is, oh, great, Brian, I saw it on video with a product. Okay, well, you can see it on video with the ball strike. I love this assist forward swing connection because we see that hip rotation and that lower body movement drastically change, and it's noticeable on video. So again, pay attention to your belt buckle. That impact position, I want the inside. So these are your checkpoints, right? Just like we did before. I want the inside of that thigh over the inside of that foot.
Okay.
Does that make sense?
Yep.
So again, if I'm at impact, I've got the inside of that thigh there, right? In addition, my belt buckle is pointing the opposite of where it was in backswing. It's going to be on the inside of that lead foot. So if you're here and you have turn, I'm already in a pretty good spot. I know all of you can do that at home, or if, again, maybe a limitation, we're going to be able to fix that, right? Through our training program. So again, I want you to feel the inside of that thigh, right? The inside of my leg over the inside of that foot, and that belt buckle's turned right there. And then after you feel that, I want you to make sure that this lead shoulder or trail shoulder is pointing down towards the ground outside the ball. So if you rehearse that, do the rev up. I've got the rev up swings presets a lot of that, right? I'm a little more forward in my swing, but I want you to check those points there. Okay. Use that. Use the products, use that rev up swing to do it. And again, okay, great. I did it on video with a training aid. Well, now you can do it on video with a ball strike, right? And from there, you've got more hip speed. Hitting balls is going to allow you to fix your matchups, right? If I increased your hip speed overnight, you wouldn't know what to do with it.
Sure.
Right? Because your club face would be open potentially, right? or something else would be occurring. So what a better way to practice at the speed of motion that we want with the coordination that we want and muscle contraction and range of motion. So you can see the four must-haves, right? The finish is the next one. Finish is really a byproduct of all these other things, but you can see how we just hit on those four must-haves in your training program and those four must-haves in your golf swing and those little bit of tips that we talked about, all right? Finish is going to, again, this connection that Jim has is going to really help us get through to that finish. But if you hit that position that we talked about in impact, from there, really, we just need to be able to sustain the energy against that. And the whip is going to help that range of motion big time. I just want you to pay attention to where you are at the finish, right? And then again, the light speed is going to really help you move through that too. The two things, your checkpoints, I'm going to give you these real quick because I want to get to Q&A. The checkpoints I like to see on finish, all right? I want to see, I call it dirty toe. You see that?
Yep.
That toe's dirty, right? The other thing I want to see, right, is I want, not only is this belt buckle there, but I've pushed my hips up and forward, right? So this belt buckle isn't down. It's pushing forward in that direction, right? Again, this is my finish. I'm not impact. All right. In addition to that, after I have that dirty toe, I've shifted the weight where my hips are. I'm squeezing that rear end. My rotary, I want you to try to do to get this belt buckle and your sternum to be pointing past the target. All right. That's difficult to do, but with some assistance, we're going to get the stretching and that range of motion. And then if I flip it around, you're going to be working against those bands.
Yep.
And if I take them off, where are you going to go?
It's going to go.
You're
going
to spin.
Yeah.
Right. So that's a short-term response, but we have the ability to do that. And then we train, which gives us that long-term effect. All right. And the things we're doing right here, you can see how they're very golf swing oriented. So using that training program, I want you to walk out of a workout and be more capable right away.
And when you bring, I mean, do this at home, do it in the gym, wherever you're going to do these training drills, it's going to, when you get to the golf course, you won't even be thinking about it. And that's usually what gets in the way on the golf course. We overthink it. If this is a natural, free flowing motion, it's the club will fly. It'll be so balanced. It'll be much more athletic.
No question. So I'm going to show you a drill that I like, and then we'll get to this Q&A. Jim, I'm going to hop on stage if I could.
Yep.
Because I want to get a little rowdy here with the light speed. All right. So I call this one long drivers. All right. And what it is it's a recoil at the end of my finish position. Oh, yeah. This is a test, right? So again, start slow with this. Do it with the whip first, and then you add the light speed. The turn trainer wearing it is going to help this. But what I'm going to do is I'm going to set up, I'm going to make normal backswing, go to a full finish, and then watch what I'm going to see. All right. So what I did is I tapped that light speed off of my shoulder, right? It's not going to hurt you. It bends. And I recoiled. And where was I in that recoil position? Where are my arms pointing? That way, right? In addition, that club, right? I'm not pointing that direction. It's out and pointing, right? It's bouncing here, coming in front of me, and you can see that because of that side bend, it's not around my body. All right, so the only way you can do that, so if I stay flat-footed, see where this bounces back?
Yep.
The reason is that when I bounce this and extend my arms, these are going to be where my sternum is. It's a tell. Where are you at your finish? So turn trainer on, long drivers, see how I extended my arms, and then if I just refolded, look at the amount of rotation that I have to do that. So do those long drivers, test yourself, right? Are you here? You see that?
Yep.
Right? So I want you to just give it a little tap off the back, right? It's going to start to slow down because of the counterweight, right? It's not moving like it is right there,
yeah.
Right? I'm going to work against it. But try that long driver. I love that. Again, and those are some checkpoints. Dirty toe, hips push forward, and then I can really test my rotation as well as my posture bends, yep. Right? So there's just some little tricks I want you to take away. We had set up, we walked through those, right? Backswing, what do we want to see? Where do we want to see the turn? Where do we want to see the bends? And what are some issues we have and how can we fix those? Impact, super important, right? We showed you some drills on how to create that body separation. And again, everything we showed you was coordination based.
Yep.
These are the four musts. Range of motion, where do we want to go and how we're going to do that, right? If I told you, if we were on the lesson tee and I said, Jim, turn your hips more.
Yeah.
I'd say, Jim, turn your hips more. Jim, turn your hips more. Jim, turn your hips more. Or I'd bring the intern over and the poor kid would be on his hands and knees trying to turn your hips. Yeah. And you'd be like, okay, he's touching me. I'm trying to hit a shot. This is weird.
Yeah.
Right. Or it's hard.
It's hard.
So the bands are going to help that. So again, speed of motion, range of motion, coordination, right? And muscle contraction is going to help you be able to take your training right to your golf swing itself, right? So use those drills, use those checkpoints. I love those. We use those across the board, right? And check out our training program, because we're blending those four must-haves with the swing and the training program, and we're blending those into a workout routine. The products thoroughly assist that aspect. And in addition to that, we're blending in some standard exercises to help your body overall. So if you do have imbalances, we're going to work on how to get rid of them, but we're going to show you how to use those fitness gains in your golf swing. Because I can make you really strong with a training program, but that doesn't mean you're going to know what to do with it,
yep,
right? Because it's a coordination movement. So those are the things I want you to keep in mind. I really hope you guys can reach out and ask questions, check out the training program. We had a questionnaire go out. We're a little bit behind because we had a lot come back in, but we're sending back results based on you filled out a questionnaire. We give you what your fitness rating is. We give you what your golf rating is based on accuracy and distance. We actually put you in a percentile based off your age and your swing speed. So it's a really cool way. And then we guide you through the program, right? Because our coordination, to train that coordination, we're going to be working on specific things that attack those flaws first. And then your overall golf swing and fitness levels are going to raise. And we always say is that it's a scale. When our fitness level goes up, our golf swing has to come with it. Think of Bryson. Why did he get better so fast? Right. Again, I mean, you could say he's injured now. He played bad. But when he advanced his body and his swing at the same time, he really did some great things. But how many times you see a tour player increase their body and their fitness and their swing falls apart?
Yep.
Because they're not functionally training. Maybe they're running to lose weight, or maybe they're, you know, even if they're doing weightlifting, the application to the golf swing, it's even harder for regular guys.
Sure.
Right.
For sure.
Even harder. I mean, you're talking about extremely talented and coordinated athletes that could still have that problem. Right. And then, you know, think of a senior tour player. Coordination's still there. It hasn't gone anywhere. But what starts to decrease? The fitness side.
Sure.
Right. So I need to make sure that I keep that fitness up to match my skills and coordination so that I can use them. Right. And that's that methodology that we like to stick to.
Let me throw this last part into about the turn trainer. The beauty of it is it can pare down to even the smallest of swings, the chipping motion. I had learned chipping with the hands way ahead. I freeze my body and I drag that handle and I chunked and bladed it like it was my job. What we learned from Stan Utley is this is the part of the club you want swinging the head. But to do that, your body has to pivot with it and turn. When Stan will finish a chip shot, even a small little one, his body is facing this direction with the club right in front of him. He has not dragged it. The turn trainer basically does that automatically. It's just allowing me to go with the shot.
Well, and the wedge does a lot of automatics too, right? You drag that handle, you're not going to be able to hit the thing.
Exactly.
So what I love is literally this right here on the lesson tee. If you're a bad chipper, this is my lesson. Turn trainer on. All right, Jim, good job. $200.
Yeah.
Right? So keep that in mind. The other thing, the way Jim had it on, spin that back to neutral for me.
Yep.
One more quick. Again, I love the features of this thing because it is so functional. Is it a little unorthodox? Yes, but so is your bad golf swing, right?
Move, but my wire is getting in the way. But
yeah, this neutral position, what do we see with bad putters? A lot of head movement,
yeah,
right? Even lateral motion in the hips.
Yeah.
What we can do now is, again, create that stability on the outside of those legs, and you're really going to be able to feel that almost heaviness, right, in those hips. From that standpoint,
it's a great feeling.
Yeah. So lag putting, this is vital. When I see somebody trying to lag putts and we see lateral motion, they got no chance of creating proper acceleration consistently. So again, this thing is neat to put on. It fits in your golf bag. And I love the features because as an instructor and a fitness trainer, the results I get are so much faster because if I don't use something like this, I'm verbally trying to talk Jim into the coordination and I can't really even go after muscle contraction, speed of motion, all that stuff,
yeah,
right? Or range of motion. I'd have to get somebody to stretch you out, right? To be able to hit some of those things. And then you could get more flexible and you don't know what the heck to do with it.
Exactly right.
Right. So again, you can see how we're doing this. Use those tips, use those drills, right? You can see this is why we design these products, right? We're not here to just talk about them. We want to show you ways to use them and ways that they can thoroughly help you in different ways. Again, our goal is to be able to teach and make golfers better anywhere in the world by having our products, having our online training program to reference, And again, if you really want to make a difference in your golf swing, make sure you're doing those four must-haves, right? From the swing and the fitness side. So thanks, guys. That was a lot of fun. Steve, do we have any quick questions? Yeah, absolutely. So turn trainer protocol, right? Without a diagnosis or, you know, just a simple way to use this thing, what we wanted to do was to create a fitness type of product, a banded product that was as simple to use as the orange whip, because that's what makes it so awesome is it does a lot of things. So the protocol that we like to see, and again, this is just across the board, it's going to help players. And if you want a diagnosis or anything like that, I mean, a lot of golfers can tell me their swing flaws. But what I want to do, and this is a great warm-up, is I like to see, go ahead and go backswing assisted.
Yep.
All right. So if you know your swing flaw.
Assisted.
Yeah, the other way. Yep. So if you know, so what he does is he just pulls his trail hip that way. If you know your swing flaw and it's, let's say it's a reverse pivot, right? I want you to make sure, I want you to work on not doing it, right? From a coordination standpoint, you maybe have a drill or a thought or anything like that. There's a million ways that we fix it, and we fix it. We provide cues in our training program. But what I like to do is I start the athlete in backswing assist, right? So what this is going to do is help the range of motion in the backswing. And the reason I like backswing assistance first is that's going to make sure that we're checking the boxes of backswing, which is what occurs before what? The forward swing. So we got to make sure that does a lot of good things, because in the lesson setting, usually backswing, if we go after it, we got a pretty good chance of then maybe developing that impact position.
Yep.
So 10 balls, that's it. You can hit driver, you can hit irons, however you like. If you warm up with a wedge, a 7-iron, you can work up and down through the bag, but I like to see 10, right? And it's going to warm you up. Swing your orange whip, right? Put the turn trainer on, swing the orange whip, and then let's hit balls, right? So after those 10, backswing assisted, right? It's helping him turn. And then he's having to fire up those muscles and joints on the way through that swing. Now we're ready to go forward swing assist. And all I want to see again is 10 balls. So you got 20 balls under tension, right? It's going to feel funny at first because, again, you're going to have to learn what to do with that speed. But that's what's great about this, right? So 10 shots. And then what we do is we pop the bands off. Honestly, you could just literally yank the belt like an eject button. Right? I mean, that's the thing is it, you don't have to get fancy with it. You're eject unless your mic's on it, so you can unhook the bands, just pop that thing off and then disconnect them, right? That's the emergency hatch. Right, so again, so from here, 10 shots regular position to allow you to functionally take these new movements and do that. This protocol, you have such a better chance to play good golf because those bands are going to be helping you turn, creating mobility, range of motion. It's going to be getting you faster in the body, which is going to help that swing speed, right? We want to hit it further. Coordination, obviously, we talked about that the whole time, right? And then muscle contraction, right? Those bands are designed, right? They're going to be helping me understand how to stabilize against them, have to turn against them. I mean, you can't help but want to push your hips through using the ground. I mean, and we measure it with a lot of devices, and it's great. So,
the last couple of swings, yeah, it was tremendous. Both sides. I mean, I felt the encouragement here and here.
Yeah, I mean, the warm-up factor alone, not to mention the coordination, is huge, right? And you swing the whip takes care of all the upper extremities, as well as the lower body, right? It's a benefit, but the whip, it swings on plane. It makes release happen. Again, if I want to give a lesson to Jim, improve his lower body and improve his swing plane, I hand him the whip, put the turn trainer on him, and charge him $200 again. Right. So you can see how we're able to do that. So 10 assisted in the backswing, 10 assisted in the forward swing, full range of motion, pop 10 off and feel the difference. And that's it. So 30 balls, that's usually around a small bucket of balls is 35 balls.
Yeah.
So most of us hit that as a warm up.
Yeah. Before you play a round of golf, your body will be ready to go out to the course. 30 balls, that quick setup, easy.
Exactly. So work through grab your wedge, go to your 7-iron, work into your driver. It's all great stuff. And that's it. So hit a small bucket. 10 assisted in the backswing, 10 assisted in the forward swing, hit 10 normally and go out and play. You're going to feel great on the first hole versus feeling like you finally stretch out on hole 17.
Yeah.
Right. You got another quick one? Right. Yeah, absolutely. So the question was, how can the products help with pulling the golf ball, right? So pulling, and again, a lot of times there's a couple ways you can pull a shot, right? Club face could be pointing well to the left, but most of the time the pulls that we see are going to be that over the topper that gets that face shut as well, right? So that 1-2-3 drill that we did is a good one, but I'm going to give you a system that's even easier to cheat. So again, I would put the turn trainer back on Jim and I would have him go in backswing assistance, right? And then the drill that I like is, yeah, I want to get you without changing anything in your swing out of the gate. The first thing I'm going to do is try to check that box of, right? And if we're on the lesson tee, I'm going to look at those fundamentals, but I'm going to check that box of backswing first, yep. Right? I'm going to make sure that we have those things that we need to have. So I love a drill that gets the student further into that depth. So if I was going to do it with the whip and the turn trainer, we call it a step backswing, right? We can start small to get the hang of it. What we do is that in your backswing, I want you to plant and pull this trail hip back. And as I do that, that's going to make it easier for me to create that depth and rotation and get that lead arm across. A lot of times, if I don't have a turn, my arms are here and then maybe I have good movement and you can see I'm going to get that high right shoulder into that position, right? So again, I would start with the backswing, right? And then as we elaborate that, you can do it with the products, the turn trainer can help. We can get a little more dynamic and create that step, right? So again, notice I'm turning this out. I'm not stepping this way. I'm literally opening this hip and feeling that depth in the swing. You can even come up and hit balls with that hip back because that's going to see that arm plane and that body get deeper, yep. Right? In addition, let's say that depth, so I would love for you to try that. That depth isn't clicking, right? Maybe you already are deep enough and you're still hitting pull shots, right? So maybe you're too deep or too inside potentially, right? It's usually the arms and hands that do it, but now you're pitching this thing over the top. So we call this L to L swings with feet together. So how do we control that low point, right? Which is, again, if I'm this way, I'm going to be hitting that pull shot. You notice my side bend?
Yep.
Went away, right? So L to L with some side bend, right? Remember what we said, right here, I'm going to get a little crunch in that shoulder.
Yep.
I'm going to put that ball right between my feet, which is, again, going to help that low point. And I'm going to have you just make some swings. We call this L to L because we're creating an L here and an L here, right? So I'm going to have you go L to L, and you can hit balls like this. We use this drill a lot to warm up because what I'm also going to do here is because I have this lever system and I'm leaned back with my feet together, one, I have to maintain my balance, right? If I lean in a wrong direction, I'm going to fall over. Two, I get this little bit of lever and that little bit of that tilt, and now all of a sudden, what do I have that everybody wants? The handle, the head's behind the handle. That's that lag, right? So again, a lot of times when we see that hook, we see that pitch, that direction, or even better players who are getting in here, right? And then they're ripping the face over and hitting that hook that we sometimes think is a pull. This is going to still allow that player to start to feel where and how to release that low point for sure. And again, hit balls with those feet together, use the whip because it's even going to exemplify that, the light speed as well. So we got to fix that low point and fix that downswing position. We can check the backswing box first, because if that hits it, great. We gain that depth by using the turn trainer. The whip's going to exemplify that, right? And if we're still having that issue, we're hitting it solid, even with that depth that we see, right? I want you to put the feet together, give me a little bit of side bend, and give me some L to L, right? And then really straighten it out from there. And then as you implement it in your swing, we want to make sure we're in that side bend position, right? And we can go into that L with the feet apart. But that should hopefully allow you to feel how to load that shaft, almost like that 1-2-3 drill like we were doing before. All right. So again, check those boxes, get the depth. That usually helps us cheat that over the top smush. And if that's not doing it, let's get that side bend in there with that L to L drill. And that's really going to help you be able to do that. Even the rev up, right? Yep. That's a great one. If it's driver specific, try that rev up a couple times where those hips are going to go first. And I bet you're going to hit it right when you first start. And that's a good sign. I want to see you pump it that way. And then you can start timing it up, right? So I hope that helps with the pull. Again, check those boxes. Four things: backswing, impact, finish, trickle in those fundamentals. Again, have eyes on you to do that with the club face and so on. And make sure when you're working those must-haves that you have those must-have components of proper training. And they're really hard to do without a program and some things that can help you do that, so that I know you're training at home with products and movement patterns that are actually going to make a difference. So I don't have to give you the same $200 lesson every time I see you.
Exactly.
Right. You get to come back and you're better.
And the beauty of it, keep the must-haves in your mind, because you can go to orangeripgolf.com, use that promo code must-haves, and that'll get you 10% off on everything that you want to purchase, as well as learn a lot more about the program that we've got. We got obviously the equipment made by Orange Rip, but we got all of Brian's fundamentals, the must-haves that are going to make you much better this winter. Come next summer, you're going to be loving it.
All right, gang. Thanks so much for tuning in. This one was a lot of fun. Jim, thanks.
Thank you, bro.
Always a blast to chat golf swing. And again, reach out to us. I do with our members, I do consultations all the time. So again, as part of the training program, it's a great way to be able to reach out. We call it talk to a coach and be able to even further understand how to guide you through those the coordination, range of motion, all that stuff that we talk about and what products can be work best for you. So I hope to hear from you guys, and always fun doing these webinars. Look forward to the next one we have coming up.